Hello everyone, my name is Silvia Kirai. Welcome to my presentation. I'm a PhD student at Staffordshire University in the UK and my research area is Olympic weightlifting. Thank you ISBS for giving me this opportunity to present my study. My study was looking at the effect of submaximal loads on trunk posture during the clean in competitive weightlifters. So let's make a start and move on to the first slide. First of all, let me just introduce you to Olympic weightlifting. Olympic weightlifting is the only barbell sport contested at the Summer Olympic Games. It involves two barbell exercises, the snatch and the clean and jerk. On this video, you will see the clean exercise. Absolutely incredible performance from this North Korean 56 kilo lifter lifting 175 kilo clean. It's a lifetime achievement for him. So if you are moving forward and looking at the phases of the clean and some technical instructions, we can see that the clean is divided into different phases, starting position, first pull, second pull, catch and recovery. Alongside all the dedication, determination and concentration, it is also very important to understand and use the correct lifting technique in weightlifting. The clean is divided into these phases based on the knee angle displacement. And during the phases, coaches use different coaching cues to teach lifters the correct lifting technique. As you can see here in the below boxes, we've got some coaching cues. So when we looked at the current research, we've seen that it was limited to a single load. For example, 85% of one repetition maximum was representing competitive performance and used by researchers. Also, it was predominantly focused on the snatch technique, focused on lower extremity kinematics. Although the importance of trunk posture throughout a lift is evident in the knowledge of coaching cues. However, there is very limited evidence on trunk kinematics during the clean. So when I said, you know, many researchers used one single load before in their research, we were questioning, you know, what is the practical application for understanding submaximal loads? First of all, to develop correct motor skills and technical proficiency, teaching weightlifting technique always should start at lighter loads. Warm-up sets prior to training and competition, setting structure during training, load management strategies in a periodized plan to maximize performance, and also load management strategy during rehab process. Therefore, the purpose of our study was to investigate the effect of submaximal loads on trunk posture in competitive weightlifters. 10 trained competitive weightlifters participated in our study and we collected data at 65, 75 and 85% of their 1RM for the clean exercise. For each load, 3 trials were collected. A 17 camera motion capture system collected marker coordinate data and alongside that, 2 force platforms collected kinetic data. The data was analyzed from the time when the barbell left the floor until maximal knee flexion in the catch. And the thorax, knee and hip joint angle and vertical ground reaction force were analyzed and considered important in relation to weightlifting performance, as we've seen in previous studies. And the phases were determined by using the knee joint angle also, as we've seen in previous studies. So before we go into the results section and discuss it, I would like to talk about the phases a little bit more in details. So when we talk about the first pull, we need to determine the start and the end of the pull. So the first pull starts when the barbell is lifted off the floor and ends when the knee reaches the first peak extension. And then we move on to the transition phase, which begins at the first knee extension peak and ends at maximum knee flexion. And we see here in the second pull, which begins at the maximum knee flexion and ends at peak knee extension. Finally, in the catch, the end of the peak knee extension to final flexion of the knees. also have to mention here that in the following results, what I'm presenting here, the phases were defined with the 65 and 75% of one arm lifts. So when we looked at the group data, we've seen similar knee hip joint angle time series waveforms across all the loads, and also similar thorax angle time series waveforms across loads during the transition and the second pull. We've seen peak thorax extension angle was the same across the loads, and also high variability was shown in performance within the group. As you can see here, the shaded area shown the standard deviation, high variability in performance within the group. Therefore, the question, does mean angle time series data represent individual performances? And we decided to look into some individual data. Here, we've got data of participant 1 and 2. For the knee and hip joint kinematics, both participant 1 and 2 displayed consistency in performance across all loads. As you can see on the graphs, 65, 75 and 85% were very consistent across all loads, hip and the angle. And then after, when we moved on to the thorax angle and looked at that data, we've seen some differences. We have to mention here that participant 1 and 2 are very similar in anthropometric measures, and their level of experience in Olympic weightlifting is very similar as well. Although there's a noticeable difference in their 1RM for the clean lift. So when we looked at participant 1 data, we've seen only minimal change in the trunk angle during the first pull. Participant two, 1 achieved the full extension across all loads towards the end of the second pull. When we looked at participant 2, there was difference. So we've seen a noticeable change in thorax flexion angle during the first pull and an incremental increase in thorax extension as the load progressed to 85% of 1RM here, as you can see the red line. So compared to the mean data, temporal differences were noted at 85% of 1RM. Summarizing our key findings, in this study, all of the lifters performed the lifts. So all lifts were successful. And the group mean data displayed similar lower extremity joint and thorax angle time series waveforms across all the loads. Group observations did not reflect individual lifting strategies. Single subject analysis highlighted individual adaptations in lifting techniques across all loads. And the increase in the intensity of loads directly affected the kinematics of the trunk region and emphasized the importance of trunk posture throughout the lift, like we said at the very beginning of the presentation. So the difference in individuals' lifting technique may explain the difference in 1RM for the clean exercise. There are some considerations. The different movement strategies can impact performance, and also a successful lift depends on the skill of the lifter as well. We need to consider the individual's training status and, very importantly, testing environment as well. So the practical research should look to create different coaching systems that would primarily focus on movement literacy by using submaximal loads to develop correct techniques before moving on to heavier loads. These are my references, and also I would like to say a very special thank you to my supervisors at Staffordshire University, Dr. Nachia Panchokalingam and Dr. Robert Needham. Thank you for supporting my academic career. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, please send me an email or find me on social media. I'm more than happy to answer.